good.
Really good balance.
Your guitar's a little hot.
I mean,
it's not really this one. She's,
you don't mind if Bear chimes in from the back.
He was in two.
Perfect time.
Dog, really?
He was a little off key, but it's hard.
It is so damp in here that I have absolutely no more play left in my bow, and I am playing the wood. Yes.
Don't thank him too much, or you'll never get rid of
him. For those who aren't fluent Irish speakers, not that many very often, that was a song called Molly Nagooch Ni Chulainn, which means Molly Cullinane of the Ringling Curls. I kind of fell in love with it because my name is Molly, and I'm glad you pretend it's about me. Don't have curly hair. But it's a song, it's actually a bit of a lament, which is funny because it has such a chipper melody, but. It's a song about a man who has lost his girlfriend, Molly Cullinane of the Ringling Curls, and he says he will do everything to win her back, including stopping drinking and buying her a cow. I wish all men had such great goals.
Yeah. All right, well, here we go.
So I think we're going to, excuse me, play a set of French-Canadian fiddle tunes. Those were a couple of Irish tunes afterwards.
Hey, Don, could you say what the names of the tunes are?
I was about to tell you because I realized there might be one or two musicians in the audience. The first of the two jigs that I played is called Cowboy's Jig, and it's an Irish jig. There were cowboys in Ireland before there were cowboys on the American West. And I followed that with a tune that I wrote called Geese in the Cold Room. And apparently the geese like to cross into the exits off the highway where two big highways meet. If there's water in there, they'll go and they molt after they lay their eggs. So it's nature's way of keeping them until the little things are grown up. And they kept crossing back and forth across two major highways outside of Boston. And people would stop and let the little goslings and their mothers and daddies cross. So I wrote this tune. So these are following now with three reels. The first is called Père Bruneau, and it's written by Lorenzo Picard. The second tune is called Ville des Accordionistes, and was written by Monsieur Marcel Le Servier for Moment. You can believe me, that's a mouthful. And then the third tune is called Les Femmes. Les Femmes. So, here we go. Tenure A.
Thank you.
But it's a song, it's kind of an interesting piece. The to it is Ojeshin Donchejin Nakmanian Shindo, which means, roughly translated, what does it matter to those who don't, it doesn't concern. In other words, mind your own business. But it's a song that's basically saying, if I want to go out and have fun all day and go home to my shack at night, why do you care? Not hurting anyone.
No, it's you. You're alone. And you
can give it a C minor.
Yeah, of course. That'd be great.
Status quo keys. There's your C.
Yeah, you are. That's why I was
fairly new to us.
Like this afternoon. This is This is one of my favorite. There's a whole, I'm mostly French-Canadian in background, and I also have one grandparent, great-grandparent, who was a Scottish fiddle player, and I didn't find out about her until my father turned 75. And then his sister told me. My family doesn't like to let on very much. So I didn't get to find out all the cool stuff until I'd already been a musician for 35 years. It's like, no, we're not going to tell her. So this is a beautiful air from the late Tom Anderson. It's called The Slocket Light. And we're going to feature Max on that. And we're going to follow this with two tunes, one that I've written and one that he's written, that we're kind of fooling around with and seeing if it'll fly on our new CD. I have several CDs. Max has a lovely solo CD of guitar music. I have three fiddle CDs out there. And for those of you who just can't get enough fiddle music, I even have books. So. Thank you.
This is, man, you are a very enthusiastic crowd. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it.
We like you. We want to bottle your energy.
Well, quiet and beautiful and sweet, and I don't know what I mean. I'm interesting to, it'll be interesting to see how this plays with the international crowd here. Become a classic. I just recently I learned this was written in the 20th century. I always thought this was traditional, but I was wrong. So, oh, you do? Then I'm not going to do that. We'll change it later. We'll see how international. I'll just do it.
Yeah, you blow the punchline.
Yeah, I don't
know what about.
See, this will be very interesting to see how this plays amongst the many different countries that are here. I know the Americans will probably get it. And I just got back from France. I'm still adjusting jet lag wise. I was ready to swear off any wine purchased in this country after going, and then Paul served us that was a very good wine. Thank you very much. Paul did a great job with dinner. Thanks both of you. Thank you, by the way, for having us. This is really a treat.
Back in grade school when I was 10, as if to prove that we were men, my friends and I would trash other's family. We were morons, I know that now. I let them call my mom a cow. Somehow that measured my ability. Then one day they threw a curve. They struck a runner and found the shameful secret I had kept. But I took it like a man. Well, I stood my stand. And then I wept, 'cause when your father looks like Mo, you know, the guy from the Three Stooges. Life can be so cruel. At school I was a sitting duck. Behind my back I heard, that wasn't bad enough. Sometimes they'd pop my nose to look at me, might see more like me. My father looked like Curly, but no, he looked like Mo. La 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 la. His shiny jet black hair cut like an Eskimo. To which I thought his reply would be some father-son philosophy. Well, all that he would say is, who the heck is Mo? I said, Dad, it's me. They tease. Well, I'm begging you, please, will you wear your hair normally? And we stood there, eye to eye, guy to guy, and he said, slightly, and your father looks like Mo, you know, the guy from the Three Stooges. Life can be so cruel, but he kept his word, he changed his hair. Went off to the barber's chair, and you would think take that, then and there, I'd have been content. But you know, that would be the year they signed up a replacement in the lineup. And you guessed my father looked like Shem.
He was a non-compliant diabetic.
Yeah.
He liked what he wanted. He liked to eat what he wanted to eat. And about halfway through the trip, we got the news that he had gone into his kidneys. His kidneys were in shock. He was only going to last a day or two more. So he said goodbye to us on the phone. And the next day we were at the Grand Canyon. Now, how many of you have been to the Grand Canyon? It is to go on your life list. It is one of the most magnificent natural phenomena in the world. And as you go to the edge of the rim, the ravens, the big black birds, they ride the thermals at the edge of the canyon. And I felt as though all day they were stalking us. And at about 4 in the afternoon, as we stepped off the last little shuttle bus, one of them landed right in our midst. Right in front of us, and went around a circle, looked around a circle till it found me, and looked me right in the eye, and clacked its beak open and shut a couple of times, and then waffled its throat feathers in and out, and then it flew off. And as we got in the van on the way back to Flagstaff, I got a call from my brother that said my dad had passed just at the same time as the raven was in our midst. So we came back from the trip. I played for my dad's memorial service not long after that. And a couple of weeks later, we were back at the house, and this tune started to come through. I had given myself the idea that I would write something for my father. And I had about half of the tune done, and Max came in from the other room and said, "Hey, the B part goes like this." And he finished the tune for me. So this is a joint composition. We called it The Raven's Wing. We cut up a quick little recording of it and sent it to my mom. And she immediately called me up and said, "Well, you know, that was the name of your dad's unit in World War II. The Raven's Wing, 101st Bombardment Group. They were in Italy." And their insignia is three ravens on a yellow background. Their newsletter to this day is called The Raven. So this is The Raven's Wing. I sent it out several days after Father's Day to my dad.
She's pretty.
that's where my learning background is. I was a musical theater major at NYU, just graduated. Oh. Now I'm in that really great stage of my 20s where I have to figure out what I'm going to do. But it's a song actually from a musical called Floyd Collins. I'm only singing the reprise, but it's a true story about a man in the 1920s who was splunking in Kentucky. We all know what splunking is, right? Cave climbing. And he was searching for a cave to make him a ton of money, a beautiful cave that he could take people on tours to, and he got caught underneath the ground. And during the process that they tried to extract him from the caves, it became one of the first big media circuses in the country. People set up tents, people started, basically this giant swarm of people ended up just in the area that he was trapped, capitalizing on the fact that he was stuck down there. And there was one man who was a reporter who was small enough to be able to sneak down and speak to him, even if he couldn't actually reach him to help. Floyd Collins did die underneath the ground. They found him, I believe, 7 days. They got down him 7 days after he had passed away of exposure, because it was winter in Kentucky. And the play is written and composed by Adam Gettle, who is the grandson of Richard Rogers, though his music is not exactly the same. And it's a folk opera, so that's why it kind of fits in our repertoire.
There he remains.
There's somebody who knows his music. Yeah, Matt's actually put this lovely piece. I think I might maybe play this for you, but I think this ended up on Max's wonderful solo guitar CD called In the Wood. It is my favorite guitar CD.
Except when she's playing with another guitar player.
It is my favorite guitar CD.
This is called Hector the Hero.
Written by J. Scott Skinner, the Scottish violinist.
Thank you.
prayer that I ever learned. And I learned it from a gentleman who has now passed, a lovely player from Canada named Graham Townsend. And I'm going to play you. I was very lucky. In the 1970s, there were still a ton of wonderful, wonderful people who mentored me, both in person and electronically. And I devoured their recordings. This was back before you had slowdown software that you could listen to things at a slower speed and retain the pitch. And even before they had slowdown, before you could have a cassette at variable speed, I used to buy multiple copies of their recordings and play them with my thumb on the edge of the LP until it was at half speed and an octave lower. And then I would record that on a cassette, so that I could tell what they were doing, because they were going too fast for me to learn it at speed. And then I would listen to that in the car on the way to and from work, and would sing along with it, and finally would learn these tunes. And this tune that I'm about to play for you is one of those tunes. there's a lovely French-Canadian musette player, button box, accordion, button, the two and three row button accordion player. He moved from Quebec to France. He lives in Annecy now. And his name is Philippe Bruneau. And this is a tune that he wrote in honor of, homage of Carmel Bégin. And Carmel Bégin was the folklorist who collected him for the Museum of Man in Canada. I'm going to follow that with a tune that I wrote called Réunion Gigue. And then later, we'll probably jump on the La Grande Gigue 5. Which is a step dance tune played all over French Canada. So we'll start with the waltz. And this is on our website, fiddlingdemystified.com. And we'll be on our new CD. Thank you. really, I just love crooked tunes. So that last third tune is kind of moderately crooked, and the middle tune, which I wrote, is another crooked jig. I love crooked jigs. I have to find callers who will write dances to them. Because contra dancing is 32 bars, very strict. So Tim, you're a caller. You want to write me a crooked dance to go with that jig?
I'll see what you can find. Everybody knows what crooked means, brother.
No.
En français, l'air tordu. Twisted tunes. So they're uneven. Instead of being one e and a two e and a one e and a two e and it might be, or one and a two and a one and a two and it's one and a two and a one and a two and a three and a one and a two and a one and a two and a three and a four and a. So they're multiple meter. So we call them crooked. Because they're crooked.
They don't add up to 16.
They're asymmetrical.
So the musicians in the audience are going.
Don't worry about it. Just listen.
All right. So we're gonna. Molly's gonna sing for us again.
All right.
And we're gonna start out with a tune that I love. Another lovely jig in E minor called Indian Point, and then an English folk song which made its way down into the Appalachian area called Cape Creole.
Yeah, but it's a little compared to your tunes. After that,
Indian Point is in the news.
Just remembering the second. No, that's afterwards, but that's so I don't forget what I'm playing afterwards.
All right. Hold on.
Thank you. Thank you.
tune that the French stole and turned into a French tune. Because they can. So yeah, the cultures up in Canada are really overlaid. The French were there before the Pilgrims came to Plymouth. And they settled there, and then after a war was settled in Europe and England won, England was ceded the right to Canada, so they came in and they kind of pushed the French off the good land.
The British threw everything up, it's fine.
It's okay, yes.
I mean, it's not.
I have a lot to answer for. But it was interesting the way that the music, that, you know, the French and the Scottish live together in these communities, and there's even a joke about, I'll tell you a joke now, we haven't told any jokes, so I'll tell a joke. And Archie Angus Beaton was the only Protestant in the entire town of Shady Camp. It meant he had no social life, because the entire social life revolved around the church. So he knew he'd never marry, no Catholic girl would marry him because he was a Protestant. So he went to Father Rankin and he said, Father, he said, I have to convert to Catholicism. He says, otherwise, might as well move out of town, and I like it here. And Father said, you know, it's going to be tough to convert to Catholicism. It's not as easy as you think it is. This was the days before Vatican III, before Vatican II, where you were able to eat meat on Friday. So Father said, will you come for instruction? So he came for instruction. And a couple of weeks later, Father said, how you doing, Archie? And Archie said, well, most of it's fine, but that I'm used to having my steak for lunch every day and having a hard time with that. So the priest says, well, every morning get up and look in the mirror and look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm a Catholic, I'm not a Protestant. I'm a Catholic, I'm not a Protestant. And that'll help. Early affirmations, So it went on a couple months. It takes a long time to do this because you have to learn your whole catechism. And on one Friday, about noontime, Father Rankin decided he would pay a wee visit to Archie's house. And he comes in there. He smells coming out of Archie's screen door. A decidedly...
stinky.
Non-fishy smell. And there's Archie, turning his steak in the pan, going, you're a trout, you're not a steak. You're a trout, you're not a steak. You're a trout, you're not a steak.
Down from his father.
true love will not have me. I will surely find another to pour wild mountain time from a long looming heaven. Will we go last evening? And will
thank you.